There it is.
Minimal.
The treasure of the ages. There it is.
Wow.
And the moon. And the moon.
The lunar age has begun.
Now let's give a warm welcome to a familiar face here at the ShuttleCon, or at the ShuttleCon at Empathy, and I believe at the entire world. Ramiro Alvarez, you know, he's a senior DevOps engineer and the lead of staff engineers at Empathy. He has participated in all three editions of the ShuttleCon, mainly because he was one of the members of the group that created this event. And apart from that, he manages a lot of things. He manages Kubernetes clusters, CI/CD orchestration, Elasticsearch, and MongoDB. And sometimes he also tries to break things on AWS, GCP, and Azure. You can also find him at international events, giving some talks. But today he's here, and he's here to talk about cloud FinOps, you know, impact in cost reduction. So big round of applause for Ramiro.
First of all, let me. Okay. Well, what? Another one. Ah, okay. Okay, thank you so much, Pablo. Thanks for the introduction. And today I'm going to talk about cloud FinOps, especially about the cost impact in your organization if you deploy a FinOps strategy. So, first of all, I'm going to introduce the agenda for today. I'm going to share with you the motivation of why FinOps, the strategy, setting the action plan to make it happen, and sharing some results based on our experience, and to summarize, close with a summary. So, first of all, what is FinOps? FinOps is just summarizing. Is bringing together technology, finance, and business. So everyone needs to work together to align all the organizational goals. And everyone, as you see in this picture, has a role to play in FinOps. The motivation is, okay, the AWS, GCP, whatever cloud, the billing is extremely transparent. So it's extremely complex to understand for someone that is not a tech guy. So the main motivation is to support financing, understand what are the savings, what are the expenses, and so on. Another thing is increased cost visibility. If you see the AWS billing is only, I spend a lot in Kinesis, I spend a lot in Redis or in Kubernetes, but I would like to understand that in, okay, I'm spending in that team, the other workload is spending a lot, and so on. So one motivation and one objective for that is to increase the cost visibility. The last one, make money, because if you are saving money, we are making money. Yes. Okay, the plan. The plan is pretty easy. The first is to try to right size and reduce the underutilization usage of everything, containers, the instances, whatever you deploy in your organization. Besides, when you are in an offboarding or deploy things, it's pretty easy, but delete things are something that you usually forget. I don't know why, but everyone forgets to delete things. So this is another thing to add to the plan, because it's pretty easy. And to summarize, to be cost efficient, it doesn't matter if how, but the plan is to be cost efficient, to do coherent actions. So how can we do it? It couldn't a good starting point is to provide a strong tag allocation. Without that, you are not talking the same language, the same vocabulary, because the first thing is, okay, what we would like to measure, what are the indicators? We would like to measure the cost of a team, the cost of a business unit, the cost of whatever. So I'm sharing with you the current mandatory tags and the recommended tags. The mandatory are the ones that if you don't have it, you didn't deploy on our systems. That's easy. The recommended tags are, okay, are recommended, but if you see the Kubernetes labels and so on, are the recommended too. But this is more like a incident, or maybe if you are in a team, in another team, you can check it where it's located in the GitHub or something like that. Or you can check easily the criticality of that service using a service tier label. Results. Okay. I said before about increase the code visibility. This is something, well, about core. But this is how we do it. We deploy a kubecost workload in each of our Kubernetes cluster, the open source version. And using the GitHub Actions, we automated everything to inject to a S3 bucket. Besides, we are using the cost and usage report from AWS that is injecting in the S3 bucket too. And we are using Amazon Athena to do queries over the S3 bucket. Pretty simple. I forgot. Everything you can see it on a Grafana dashboard, of course. And everything in the Grafana is accessible for everyone. So this increase the transparency in the cost visibility and increase that everyone can play a role. You don't need to be a from the C group to see the cost. So I would like to spend a little bit more time here instead of doing some numbers or something like that. I'm going to highlight five topics that were the most enjoy, the most cost savings for us. So first of all, the Kinesis right-sizing. Kinesis is an AWS queue, and it's pretty easy to scale, downscale, whatever. But it has a cost. Another thing is remove the unused resources, especially features that we abandon and nobody knows what is the owner and so on. The container right-sizing, because when you are alone in a restaurant, you don't order food for 100 folks. So this is going to be the same. Request what you need, nothing else. I forgot to say, these three topics are pretty low time consuming and a pretty high impact. We'll see later the impact, and I can tell you. These couple of things are, I would say, mid-time effort. We spend a week to do it. Pretty big impact too. One is a migration from Elastic Cache in AWS to Kubernetes. It has some implications because, well, some years ago we were in more comfort in AWS than in Kubernetes, and it was simpler for us to deploy a Redis cluster. But it has some cost, and we are here to reduce the cost. And the start using some open source tools to scale based on external metrics instead of the typical horizontal pod auto-scaling that is based on CPU and memory and it's so bored. So, the Kinexi sample. I'm going to share here some screenshots from the five topics and explain a little bit. As you can see, the provision, you have a button that is edit provision shards. You can click, put 9, and this is going to be 3 times cost. That's it. And to scale down is the same, but you usually forgot to downscale. So you are giving money for free to AWS. I forgot to say, we save $10,000 per year in this Kinesis resizing. Remove the resources. I think that this is pretty simple. Press the button, the delete button, and that's it. No, just joking. It's not that simple. Maybe you need to delete some code, do some changes on the interaction between the services, between the dependencies. But I mean, it's pretty low time effort, a pretty big impact in cost. The container resizing. Some years ago, you can do a resizing of your containers, but it was kind of art of the observability because you need to check the metrics of your CPU memory based on the last couple of days, last 7 days. But thanks to KubeCost, you have a recommendation just in a button. So this is going to reduce so many time for us to have a recommendation. This is not the final status of the workload of the CPU and memory, but well, it's pretty good. It's well recommended. So when you deploy a KubeCost in your cluster, you are going to have a cost savings estimation. So you can go application by application doing this container resource. Container resizing, sorry. Okay. The migration from Elastic Cache to Kubernetes. As I said before, it's pretty simple to deploy Elastic Cache in AWS, but at the same time, it has some caveats. For instance, there are no way to, you always have one CPU, two CPUs, four CPUs, eight CPUs, 16 CPUs. It's always multiply per two. So it looks pretty nice, but at the end, is you are going to over-provision your instance because it's almost impossible to fine-tune in that. So deploying in Kubernetes, you can set your container request and you can fine-tuning your CPU and memory. And maybe you would like to use 0.5 CPUs and 32 megabytes. So for instance, I did a screenshot of one of our cluster, and as you can see, it's 80 milli CPUs of usage and 143 megabytes. So you can imagine how many sites you are over provision with the Elastic Cache instances. I lied before because I'm going to share numbers. So for staging, we save around $700 per year, and in production we save $10,000 per year. This is, you can imagine, but the transition from the Elastic Cache to Redis, a part of our over-provision from the Elastic Cache, the fine-tuning and the Kubernetes cluster is easier. At the end, it depends to if in your teams they are comfortable with Kubernetes, because everything is going to be deployed in the same way. You can have the same monitoring way in the Prometheus and so on. So this was a 1 week of effort for us, but the cost is, I think, that is well paid. The KEDA Zero Auto Scaling. As I commented before, the usual horizontal pod auto scaling in Kubernetes is pretty boring. You can check the CPU average utilization, and this is so man, that's we are in 10 years ago. I would like to start using metrics because this is one of the reasons that I have it. For instance, this is the KEDA autoscaler is an operator, no, it's a workload that you deploy in your Kubernetes cluster, and it's like a horizontal pod autoscaling, but with more powerful, I mean. So you can set the query that you would like to send to your Prometheus and work based on that. For instance, for the example application we are going to, it was a deployment, so 24/7 up and running, spending a lot of resources, but it was a indexation method. So you need to, you don't need the index pipeline always up and running. You only need the index pipeline up and running when you have something to index. So to summarize, you can see here a screenshot about one of our of this application, and it's not all the day up and running. So all the gaps, we are not spending money. We are making money. And because it doesn't matter if it's one replica. I mean, it was like nothing. It could be one replica, but 100 CPU. But this was like a peak of 3 CPUs and almost 4 gigabytes of usage. So this is going to be a good savings in the 24/7 average. So, oh, I forgot that I shared this. Okay. This is the final results on our journey. I encourage you that you apply the same in your organization, because I think that is a pretty good way to do a more sustainable world. You don't need a Tesla to do it. You can do it in your organization and in your Kubernetes cluster and whatever you would like to, whatever you deploy. So to summarize, we save in a couple of months of effort almost $120,000 per year. This is the savings, the real ones, not the potential ones. As you can see in the remote unused resources, it was a lot, totally a chaos. But the migration is a pretty good example that maybe you need to rethink about your approaches to the systems, and maybe be a little bit disruptive. Okay, we are using Elastic Cache because we did it all the time, but maybe you can have potential savings in Kubernetes or some other platforms. So, the end. To summarize, create a FinOps strategy. It will be key to increase your cost visibility and start understanding your business, finance, and technology things. Besides, I encourage you to create coherent actions. Don't start to be crazy. Start little by little. Write a pretty good task allocation strategy based on your requirements, because maybe are not the same as us. And start taking influence in business decisions based on metrics, because you can say, okay, if we do that, we are going to spend or we are going to save X. So this is a pretty good thing to influence the business decisions. And that's all for me. Thank you so much, guys. Thank you.
There it is.
Minimal.